Did somebody say Italy? Another Italian, Claudio Chiappucci, is thirsty for a win. And the field snakes back into Stuttgart, somewhat spread out for safety's sake at 45 miles an hour. For Bruiser Bontempi, the motivation is more than national pride. It's money. Should an Italian win, each team member will share in a pool of some $300,000 put up by bike manufacturers and team sponsors. No other nation has such a lucrative bonus incentive. At the moment, it seems to be working. Back on the flat, the pack still follows Bontempi. One man can't hold off an army forever, but Bontempi's been doing it for more than an hour. And the Tifosi, ever mindful of the past but looking to the future, are loving it. We'll pause for a moment, and now to Gail Gardner in New York for the Prudential Update. Stuttgart, a city of a half million. It is the garden-like capital of the German state of Baden-Württemberg. It is a triumph of urban planning, with broad squares dotted with magnificent fountains, and green parks peppered with chestnut trees and azaleas that stretch to the banks of the Neckar River. Like most large cities of Europe, Stuttgart has many well-preserved castles and churches. But unlike other burgs, the tone for its skyline is set by medieval towers, not skyscrapers. The modern touches, of course, are there, such as the swift convenience of an immaculate trolley system. Despite heavy bombing damage during World War II, the landmarks of tradition still stand tall. Just like cycling, Stuttgart's a blend of the old and the new Europe. It's not traditional German cuisine, but bicycle racers must eat every couple of hours during a race. Feed bags are carefully packed with a palatable mix of small sandwiches, jelly rolls, fruit, and fast-acting energy bars. The carbos to go are grasped by racers as they roll swiftly through a designated feed zone. Greg LeMond will get his sack from his personal trainer. Otto Jacome has been working with LeMond for 5 years and spends more time with Greg than his family. Meanwhile, LeMond's wife, Kathy, watches the race from the U.S. team cabin. She knows Greg hasn't felt strong since the Tour de France in July. Question is, do you ever count out the three-time Tour de France champion?
With some famous names already in retirement, the race continues at speed. Over 3 hours have passed, and the race is half over. The pressure is being felt. At the feed station, busier it seems than Grand Central, it's blocked by team supporters anxious to ensure that their riders have enough fluid and food on board for the battle still to come. The initial wearing down process almost at an end, and the time is coming to move on towards stage two, the attacks. Greg LeMond has survived phase one and stokes up now for the next crucial leg. Will a season of poor results by LeMond standards mean difficulties ahead? Of the 191 starters, still 150 survive. So as they move out towards the climb again, the field begins to offer a choice: attack or defend. A sharp acceleration from a Danish rider, and the first pedals of anger are turned. Now the rest must react as the world title begins to move up a gear. Others follow, and soon a group of riders form at the front. Blue jersey of Italy too is prominent, but the majority of these attackers are not dreaming of world titles, but more of just keeping an eye on things, in the hope that later their team leaders will join. In professional cycling, these men are called the domestiques, but it's not unknown for helpers to lift world titles either, as Rudi Dornans did last year. Eight riders take charge, the first to do so since this race began. The challenge has been issued and the championship declared open. None of the expected names have taken part in this opening skirmish, instead preferring to wait and see how it develops. This course is very hard, and the hill continues to strike fear into most of the field. At first, no reaction is forthcoming. No one is inspired. But soon, the main reaction comes from Claudio Chiappucci, the Italian who can always be relied upon to liven things up when the pace gets too slow for his liking. Chiappucci's accelerations are deliberate and painful for the rest, and the reaction begins the chase down towards the leaders. It's all part of the Italian plan. Gianni Bugnot too joins in. The Italians use every opportunity to show their dominance, and they look very strong indeed. Inch by inch, the breakaways are brought back to heel, but the names of the chasers have been noted. The strong men have been alert, and now the world title will have to be fought with that in mind. The message is clear. To win this race, the Italians will have to be beaten, outthought, and outwitted. And the men to be moved over appear to be Chiappucci, Bontempi and Bugnot. Bugnot, second in the Tour de France, needs this title to solidify his reputation as the world's number one. The race is now over halfway, and Italy have not made a single mistake yet. But Italy have ridden like this before, lost the race. The others might do well to remember that.
And so the Italians have answered the first test of their unity and resolve with a convincing show of strength. It was a response that cost Gianni Bugnot nothing in wasted energy. Right on plan, his teammates are doing the work now, and he will be expected to do it later on. This is the way every team operates, protecting and sacrificing for their leaders with the hope that he will be the strongest at the end. And right now, one of the strongest, and from this picture, the most confident, is Gianni Bugnot. We'll be back with more of the World Championships after these words from your local station. Stay with us. Welcome back to the World Cycling Championships from Stuttgart, Germany. I'm John Tesh, along with Phil Liggett. The first breakaway of the day has been foiled, and there's a momentary lull before the next attack, which is certain to come soon. When it does, this pack will tighten into a thinner, straighter procession. The most efficient way to fight the wind and squash the escape attempts of a small group. We're not even into the heavy racing yet, and it's clear that bike racing is not just stamina, it is also a game of chess. Now, American Greg LeMond has so far kept a low profile, but that's fine with him, thank you. And a smile comes easily when Moreno Argentine tells him about getting tangled in a Tifosi's flag earlier in the race. Maybe LeMond's not feeling so badly after all. After a full decade as a star, LeMond knows what fans can do to help and hurt you. He's now the 30-year-old veteran. The dream began in the Washoe Valley of Nevada, a 17-year-old living a European fantasy. While other kids strapped on football helmets, LeMond's chin strap held an Italian leather hairnet. LeMond won his first big game at 22, taking the world championships. And he took his hard knocks when he was brushed aside for the glory of a weaker French teammate in the 85 Tour de France. Then one of the most unforgettable moments in all of sport, winning the Tour after walking on the edge of death because of shotgun wounds. And then an exclamation point. Another world title. And in the world of cycling, LeMond was known simply as Superman. Then he returned to America to the adulation and autographs of a true sports hero. But this year, for the first time, LeMond struggled in the Tour de France.
I've always gone into the Tour with an idea that I was going to win or be. I was always on the podium. I was pretty tired. This is the first time I've ever been that tired from the Tour, which is normal. I push myself maybe even deeper than when I've won the Tour.
The man who had never had a bad day in the Tour de France suddenly had four, bringing sadness in a race that had usually brought him joy.
I was probably just as good as I've ever been in the Tour, and I killed myself to limit the time that I lost, 8 minutes. I could have easily lost more if I would have just ridden my normal tempo.
In last year's Worlds, he finished an unspectacular fourth and never showed the aggressive streak of a clear champion. This season, as usual, started slow. He played a supporting role in the Tour de Pont and was often the comic saving the game phase for July.
It's fine when you're an up-and-coming rider and you don't have the pressures of being on top. You can handle it for a year or two, but once you start getting the reputation where you have to always excel in each race you go into, it's difficult to go on each race and have to win.
If anyone knows what a world title can do for a career, it is Greg LeMond. His first win introduced him as a star, and his second put him into the ranks of the all-time greats. The podium at the World Championships is very familiar territory for America's greatest cyclist.
The most two most important events for me, and I think for almost any rider in the peloton, is the Tour de France and the World Championships. I'm sure I have the best record of any professional right now in the World Championships, and that's because I've made it a very high point of the season for me. I mean, I've always focused on this race also in terms of trying to peak for it.
And so today, Greg is curled over his bike, ready for battle, but way in the back of the pack. It's the worst position possible for responding to attacks or mounting one of your own. Not a good sign for Le Mans.
Spain, who has never won a world title, but their confidence boosted by Indurain's victory in the Tour de France, launch an offensive on lap number 9. Jesus Rodriguez makes the hill look quite tame. With 7 laps remaining, Rodriguez is the sacrificial lamb for more famous countrymen, such as Pedro Delgado and Miguel Indurain. His move intended to draw the sting from the other favourites. Spain has attacked. Others must react, or the Spanish team will defend their new position. Claudio Chiappucci rides behind the Spanish, holding a position from where he can keep a close eye on any possible reaction. While Delgado sets the pace, Chiappucci's impatience is clear, as he can't wait any longer to stretch his legs in pursuit of Rodriguez. The reaction behind is immediate too, and soon others will take their cue from Chiappucci and begin to chase the leader as well. Chiappucci was virtually unknown until he finished second to Greg LeMond in last year's Tour de France. But this year, he's developed into one of the world's best riders. Indurain is now behind and marked by another Italian, the team whose riders seem to be everywhere. The attack results in a leading group of 8 men. The most dangerous and most talented by far is Claudio Chiappucci. And what started as a Spanish strategy has developed into an Italian coup. Other professionals, it's said, don't like Chiappucci because he attacks without rhyme or reason. Here he's in the leading group and is still not content. Last year, Chiappucci came from nowhere to become a superstar when he held the yellow jersey in the Tour de France for 8 days, only to lose it in the final weekend's time trial to Greg LeMond. Even so, he was still seen then as a lucky challenger to LeMond, never to be heard from again, perhaps. Now he's determined to prove once and for all he's one of the elite riders of the world. With Chiappucci in the lead group, the breakaways have substance, a leader and an Italian. They know what the might of the Italian team behind will try and do. They'll try to slow down the chase in favour of Chiappucci. The riders in this break can take advantage of that. This is the first significant move since the race began, and Italy has released a superstar into the lead group. It's early into the race yet, but Chiappucci's reputation is such that riders behind will be unable to ignore such an attack, and a chase group is developing. It contains members of every significant nation. As the race nears the end of another lap, Spain, who'd started the attack, now had no one in the lead group. As the leaders head towards lap number 10, Chiappucci chews on the thought that soon he might be a world champion. But his effort now, with still half the race to run, could be too soon. But this is why the gadfly of world cycling annoys his contemporaries so much. He's pushing the pace early on, when most favourites would prefer to take it a little easier. Now they are forced behind to work hard, using energy that they would have preferred to have saved until later. The field is splintering in desperate pursuit. Chiappucci's attack has disturbed the peloton. At this stage, no one can know whether Chiappucci's attack is for his own good or just to divert attention away from other Italian stars like Bugno. Because no one knows, they have no choice but to answer the call and chase him down.
Thank you.
And so Chiappucci has done his job well, and the field is about to swallow up the breakaway. The Spaniards move to the front of the pack, knowing that a new attack is likely to come just when the two groups are about to merge. Up ahead, the breakaway has no hope, really, particularly German Rolf Aldag, who is having trouble here with his chain. In this kind of race, you cannot afford to lose your rhythm, much less a piece of your equipment. No one's going to wait for you to fix the thing, and there is no time to wait for someone to fix it for you, so you do it yourself. An adjustment, a push, which, by the way, is legal, and partisan cheers will help keep him in the race. But the breakaway, forget it. As you can see, the World Cycling Championships are a street cleaning crew's worst nightmare. It's a tradition to chalk or paint the name of your favorite star on the road surface, usually on the biggest climbs. The theory is the stars will see their names and somehow find the energy to pedal faster. The fans come out here, many of them in the dark hours of the early morning, to scratch out their favorites. This graffiti will still mark the roads of Stuttgart when the worlds are just a distant memory. We'll be back. Professional World Road Championship is now the prestige event. But in cycling's early days, there was only track racing. Marshal Major Taylor of Worcester, Massachusetts, won the world sprint title just before the turn of the century and took his fame to Europe, where he was revered as the fastest bike racer in the world. Track racing on splintered indoor ovals remained a wildly popular U.S. spectator sport, building on a tradition that began with the sport's first world champion, A.A. Zimmerman. Cycling's top stars were as well-known as Babe Ruth or Jack Dempsey. The racing format was the six-day and around-the-clock competition. While one team member circled the track in the wee hours, the other got a shave or a hot meal. The six-day was zany, but its appeal was mostly cycling's unique blend of speed and danger. This brand of cycling faded, victim of promoter infighting, the car, and the growing popularity of once lesser-known sports, baseball and football. Bike racing endured in Europe. It was a working man's sport, an escape from a factory job for a promising young rider. Every nation had its cycling heroes, even Germany, as it celebrated the world championship of Rudi Altig. Finally, the sport reemerged in America, pumped by a small band of imaginative race promoters and riders who dreamed of someday competing in the Tour de France. America had the terrain and a few events, but not many top athletes. Then came Greg LeMond. He had the physical strength, a competitive flair, and the drive to carry his dream to Europe, to the World Championships and beyond. Pro cycling is a hard life, and LeMond has often suffered. But now he is reaping all the rewards. What's impressive about Greg is that he has been able to beat the Europeans at their own game. LeMond is as revered and sought after there as Joe Montana is in this country. The decisive laps of the World Road Championship are now approaching, and the crowd, they know it. They've come to their windowsills, pressed closer to the barriers. The people here will do anything they can to get the best possible look at the very best in the world of cycling.
Claudio Chiappucci has taken over command at the front of the World Championship. The little 28 years old Italian has put himself in a position to win the world title. He's in a group of six riders, and the chase behind is never more than 40 seconds. The Spanish team, they started the move and then fell away from it, are guarded by the blue jerseys of Italy, and are now being forced to chase once more. Chiappucci, his known impetuosity has placed him in this front group, but he can expect no great assistance from those alongside him. Chiappucci is a favourite, but the rest here are not, and they would prefer to swap places with their leaders behind, so their job is to try and slow down the Italian. Chiappucci has few friends. That Spain is being left alone to chase is another clear indication that the rest of the world also fear Miguel Indurain. If the Italian is caught, advantage could swing to the Spanish. The leaders begin their descent once more, but their advantage is still only a few seconds. Kiyopuchi's energy release is carrying him nowhere fast. The long descent gives the Spanish, more noted for their climbing ability, a chance to show their skills on the way down. And at 60 miles an hour, they slowly reel in Kiyopuchi's group. But again, at what cost to their own strength? Racing in parallel with Stuttgart's famous tram lines, the escapers are finally sighted, and recapture is but a moment away. Five Spanish flyers give everything to arrest Kiyopuchi, knowing that if they do, the man not present here, Miguel Indurain, their team captain, will again be in with a chance of victory as the field regroups. First scare of the day, and there will be many more, has been met mainly by the Spaniards. They have shown their intent to try and win this championship for the first time in their history. Italy have played a trump card too, but in their team, they have many such cards. Tenacious Bunch is once again as one. The champion-elect still an anonymous face among many. Could it be Greg LeMond? He has survived and survived well the opening 100 miles. There are fewer than 60 to go. Could he be plotting the next move of this tactical race?
With LeMond at the back of the bunch and most of the team already out of this race, American fans haven't had any reason to get excited. Many of these U.S. racers rarely ride races longer than 100 miles. Often their stateside events are less than 50. They come to Europe a couple of weeks before the Worlds, suffer and struggle in the tough conditions, then arrive at the championships hoping for a miracle. It's an impossible step up that nearly always ends like this, with a lonely seat in a canvas tent and a chance to see your dream played live without you on a TV monitor. For a young U.S. pro who wants to follow LeMond in the ranks of the European pro cycling world, a strong performance at the Worlds is essential. You can't get noticed as a great bike racer sitting in a tent. Kathy LeMond has sat in the U.S. tent many times, but she's never seen her husband roll in before the end. He has never quit. But out on the course, LeMond isn't looking strong or happy. He's still near the back of the pack, nowhere near the other superstars of cycling. In the World Championships, this is a position LeMond has never known. 47 miles remain, 5 laps to go. Eric Breukink of Holland mounts an impressive solo attack. Until now, the Dutch haven't done much in this race, but Breukink, the Tour de France champion, is a serious threat. He was a top candidate to win the Tour de France this July until he and his entire team had to drop out from illness. Holland has few hills, but Breukink is a fine climber. Like Indurain, he left a promising soccer career behind to pursue cycling. In Europe, he is known as a rider who pedals with ease, a calm exterior that hides a supercharged engine. The field knows Breukink's abilities well and begins to grind harder. Breukink, a master of solo time trialing, is one of the few riders in this race with any chance of staying ahead for the 2 hours that remain. Even if he doesn't succeed, he may force the Italians to change their strategy. This time, it's the French, paced by LeMond's longtime rival, Laurent Fignon, who leads the counterattack. Fignon is usually in the thick of the world's action near its end, but he's never won. Fignon showing the form that has won him 2 Tours de France. And now it has become cat and mouse. At the back of the pack, a crash. Greg LeMond has fallen, but is not seriously hurt. But his slow, half-hearted effort to check his bike for damage and remount is not the style of someone who thinks they still have a chance. From the beginning, he's admitted to not being in good form. And as the seconds tick by, LeMond is losing ground. Drops back to try and tow LeMond back forward toward the field. The question now is, how hard will Greg be willing to work to get there? Ahead, the French pace chase is succeeding, and Roy Kink spies the field just behind him. LeMond continues to push forward, but tentatively. Field still chasing Breukink is moving faster and leaving LeMond further behind. After failing to win this year's Tour de France that he wanted so badly, LeMond looked to the world as an opportunity to salvage a season, to say that at age 30, he's still the best. Can Greg make that statement here in Stuttgart? We'll find out.